Please welcome Oliver Twist.
What a name, Oliver Twist. Where does that come from?
Oh, I invented that. No. It's a name I adopted when I was adopted into the Australian immigration package, really, when
was
I came here.
Was there a reason you chose that name in particular?
No, no particular reason. I'm very fond, you know, of Dickens, Charles Dickens, who's... Yes. whose real name was Mazumbuko Ntombingo, by the way. So we have that in common. We both just swapped names. It was just a name that I picked when I first moved to Australia. Yeah, so I'm very fond of it.
You've built your show around telling the story of coming from Rwanda, ending up in Australia eventually. There was a lot of hardship, I think, along the way, it's fair to say.
Yeah.
What about that led you to then handling it through comedy?
What about that led me to handling it through comedy? Because my family, I like to think, are very funny. Okay. And I like to think that the hardships that we actually went through are better received when we have this kind of funny tone to it.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how I started approaching it, really.
Did you and your family see it as funny at the time? Like,
oh, no,
you...
obviously not.
What's funny about fleeing genocide?
Yeah,
you know?
There's nothing hilarious about it. If there were, there would be a lot of funny people. A lot of people that I displaced. There would be, like, millions of comedians out there. But that is not the case. We didn't find it funny at the time, but it's a retrospective thing. So it's only possible after I came to Australia, obviously. And it's a show that only works, by the way, to, like, people that have never been in that situation. You know, people are always like, oh, have you done this show or would you do some of these stories to people who have experienced it? I'm like, no, this has no...
That would be triggering.
Yeah, it would be triggering, if anything. It would not be a fun show for them to watch. Absolutely.
You've gone from comedy to a theatre show to a memoir.
Yes.
Surely, I mean, obviously everything is about storytelling and you would have had so many stories that have come through this experience, but I would imagine that the transition from a refugee camp to regional Queensland would be quite the trip.
Yes. regional Queensland, specifically Ipswich, to be exact, which is notoriously not my place. you know, it was for the first time that I left Zaleka refugee camp and arrived in Ipswich and I was like, this is worse somehow. Possible, you know. So I had to really reconfigure myself. The resettlement part really felt real when I was in Ipswich. But yeah, the story really is me sincerely trying to share these anecdotes. So whatever form they embody, it just became more, it made more sense that it just ended up in a memoir, that it was a natural progression for me.
What's the biggest culture shock arriving in regional Queensland?
Oh, I don't know. It feels like it's been a long time ago now, but I was not built for Ipswich. I moved to Sydney.
The dinner party story about the plate.
Oh, that was a long time ago now. I really don't remember that story, but what's more exciting is the kind of the welcoming nature that I have found in Sydney, which is really, really nice.
But you've always been kind of, I guess, an entrepreneur, a hustler. tell us about what you used to do to make money in the camp when you were there.
Are you alluding to my bootlegging days?
Your side business.
Oh, how very subtle of you, Mike. he knows me and we know each other.
Friends,
this is why he's bringing this up. I used to bootleg and sell porn in a refugee camp. I know. This is very shocking even to my family that have never really heard of this for the first time until now. But I was bootlegging and selling porn in a refugee camp because even refugees need to come. come to Australia and come when they do get to Australia. It was and still is a very profitable business, by the way. If I ever need to fall back on some skills, some technological skills, I'm there. Absolutely.
That is wild. Hey, there's a particular African proverb you quote when you're talking about your show.
Yes.
Can you tell us what it is and what it actually means to you?
Well, when I began doing the show, so the show is called Jali, and Jali, the term itself, means a storyteller. And I was thinking about what storytelling means to me, coming from where I come from in East Africa, and identifying with an oral tradition of storytelling in Africa. And I was going through these proverbs that mean a lot for me. And one of them is, when the music changes, so does the dance, which is the end of the play named Jali, which is also the memoir, which you can pre-order. And
get plug is coming there. Up.
And that to me is, it's not new to me, but it was new when I rediscovered it, which is we have this spiritual energy of adapting to whatever circumstance we're thrown into. And that is the very definition of being an asylum seeker, ending up in a new place like Ipswich, and then they're like, well, figure yourself out. That's it.
Jali, the memoir, is available from the 1st of August. It's available for pre-order right now via the link on our website. Would you please thank the wonderful Oliver? Yeah.